All right, greetings from the Dark Continent, Conscious Caracal here, and I usually shine a light on the goings-on down south, meaning South Africa, but we're going to expand that lens a little bit and look at our neighbours over in Zimbabwe, or as we will be referring to it tonight in a historical context, Rhodesia. And I'm talking here with Scott McClaren. He is a descendant of Rhodesians and technically an ex-Rhodesian, but we're going to get into that history as well. And tonight we're just going to dispel some myths, get into the history, and give people something interesting to listen in regards to a country that I think, as me and Scott have talked about it, taken on kind of a mythical character, that some of it might be founded in truth, some of it might be founded in myth. Let's see if we can shine some light and get some clarity on that tonight. Welcome on the show, Russell.
How's it, Ernst? Look, you got my name right there in the end, you know, Scott's my brother.
That's right. But also, while on that topic, Russell and Scott also have a YouTube channel that you can find the link to in the description. So when you're done listening to this episode, you can go check it out. Link is there in the description for your convenience. So Russell, before we get into the meat of the topic, maybe just get out of the way what your history is to Rhodesia and where your knowledge comes from.
Well, it's quite interesting. I come from a family who's both sets of grandparents actually moved from South Africa after the war. My both grandfathers, the one grandfather left Cape Town, and the other grandfather left King Williamstown, and they both moved. The one moved to Salisbury, as it was then. And the other one moved to my grandfather from King Williamstown moved to what was then Northern Rhodesia, near, just outside Lusaka. And my dad grew up basically in Broken Hill, which is now called Kabwe, in near Lusaka, on a farm outside there. My grandfather was a brickmaker, and he. He grew up there until he was 16 years old. He came back down to South Africa to train to become an electrician. And then he moved back to Rhodesia shortly after that, in the 60s. My other grandfather moved to, my mom's dad, moved to Salisbury and worked in Salisbury, raised a family there. My mom was born in Salisbury. So, that's the kind of history. And then my parents met actually in South Africa. They met in Pietermaritzburg, where my mom was studying. My dad was doing apprenticeship. And they eventually met, got engaged, got married at the Presbyterian Church in Salisbury. And they then moved later on back, that was in the 70s, and then I was born in the 70s. That's pretty much my connection to the, Rhodesia. And I've got cousins and uncles and that sort of thing that are still got connections and everything, connections to who were born there, and none of them live there anymore, unfortunately. But that's kind of like my background on a family basis to the country. Mm. I said I left when I was 3 years old.
Mm. But you still have a Rhodesian ID or passport, or what is it?
Yes, strangely enough, I do have a Rhodesian passport with me, with a picture of me when I was 2 years old. And my entry into South Africa in April 1980 or something like that.
Excellent. Russell, before we continue, there's a clicking sound coming from your side. Do you know what that is?
Don't worry. I've sorted it out.
All right. Excellent. Now that you've covered your history, I don't know how knowledgeable you are in the topic, but we'll find out now in regards to the history of the country. So, and that's something that I think a lot of people misunderstand in regards to how the country formed, where the history comes from, and how it ended up where it is today. And that will form a part of the later discussion. So if you could cover the early history, I think that'll form a nice foundation for the rest of the conversation.
Yeah, basically, it started in the 1890s. at the peak of the Victorian era expansionist policies of Cecil Rhodes. He formed a company in Cape Town called the British South Africa Company. And basically what that company was, the purpose of that company was to pioneer new lands. And it undertook an administrative and explorative function. And they then crossed into the Limpopo, had a brief encounter with the Matabele in around Bulawayo, had a couple of battles there. They eventually made peace with Lobengula. They eventually made peace with all the Bantu tribes, the Shona, etc. And they eventually ran the country until this company actually ran the country until 1923, when Rhodesia was granted, I think it was some kind of a dominion status, which basically kind of made them very much a self-governing area, they then, what happened later on, they formed a federation in the 1950s, the Federation of Rhodesia and Nyasaland, and that was including Malawi, Northern Rhodesia today, Zambia, Nyasaland being Malawi today, and Southern Rhodesia, which is Rhodesia or Zimbabwe today. And that federation lasted, I think, until about 1964-65, and that was when the federation broke up. Zambia got its independence, Malawi got its independence, and Rhodesia actually declared a unilateral declaration of independence, as UDI.
Yeah, so that's the UDI that everyone refers to, yeah.
Correct, yeah, yeah. And that I think that was in 1965.
Yes. That's 4 years after South Africa declared itself a republic in 1961.
Yes, yeah. Well, the 60s were tumultuous times in Africa, I think.
If you want decolonization, that's where you need to go.
Yeah, well, look, I mean, the thing is, it's already, what was the first African country? I think it was Ghana in 1961 or something like that.
To declare independence.
Yeah, either Ghana or Uganda, I'm not sure, but...
If you can continue with that history there from in the UDI, I'll check that fact for you.
Yeah, so what happened then after UDI, basically it became a whole political wrangling between Britain and Rhodesia as to Rhodesia, Southern Rhodesia were under the impression that they would be the first, if federation broke up, everybody would go their separate ways. So that, and their understanding was, reading Ian Smith's biography years ago, was that because of Southern Rhodesia effectively was a caretaker of Northern Rhodesia and Nyasaland, almost had like a caretaker role. And when federation ended, Rhodesia would simply go its own way, so to speak, you know. And... you know, look, the UDI thing, I think Rhodesia found itself on the kind of wrong end of policy. The policy had already been decided, no matter what anybody in Rhodesia actually thought. The policy had been decided. It was that or nothing. You know, there was the only option that the international sort of community said, and that's what brought along UDI. And I think the idea behind UDI was to eventually reach a better settlement. That it was to buy time to try and reach a better settlement.
That was always with the empire.
Sorry, say that again.
A better settlement with the empire.
Well, I think externally and internally, you know, one of the biggest myths about UDI was that it had no internal support amongst the black population. That's a myth. There was actually as the Federation broke up in the months leading up to UDI, there was actually a massive gathering outside Salisbury where pretty much every traditional leader from every corner of the country was invited. And they spent like a week discussing the matter. And it was pretty, they reached a consensus, the tribal chiefs and traditional leaders reached a consensus saying that they actually felt they needed to, their consensus was that they would go with the Rhodesian government. It's not very well known. That's a bit, you know, they like to make out that the Rhodesian government was this bastion and preserver of white supremacy and all this sort of thing. But the reality is that the traditional leaders were pretty much on board with, they had come to consensus that it was the best route to go amongst themselves. And the way forward, it was in the best interests of the black African majority at that point in time.
And then the sanctions started being put on Rhodesia, and you became one of the skunks of the world.
Yeah, look, I think it was pretty much, that's when you're pretty much cut off and you are forced to look internally. One of the advantage of being a small country like Rhodesia was, you've got a small dynamic type of economy. And you actually are, it doesn't have as many moving parts as a sort of industrial, heavily industrialized, massive country. It's actually easier to manage. So the sanctions actually didn't work. They didn't work at all from an economic perspective. Rhodesia's economic growth rate in the 1970s, from about 1960, from like 65 to 74, Rhodesia's economic growth rate annually was about 8-9% annually, GDP growth. So it was actually very good times, stable prices, good investment. I think in 1973, it was, 80 or 85 Rhodesian cents to the pound. You know, that was in about 1972 or something like that. And at the same time, it's interestingly enough, when Rhodesia's economy was actually booming in that period, in the late 60s, early 70s, the United Kingdom was going through a terrible time. In the 1970s, so much so that immigration from the UK to Rhodesia actually increased over that period. They actually had thousands of people moving actually to Rhodesia to take up job opportunities. It's quite ironic, you know, the country that your country is sanctioning, trying to destroy economically, you going there to go and get some work, you know.
I see here's a comment regarding that. Sideliner Opinion says, without a harbor, Rhodesia was stuffed. What are your thoughts on that sentiment?
Well, that only, I'll get to that later. That's why I specifically mentioned 1974, because by the time 1975 rolled around, I think it was 1974, 75, around there. It was pretty clear to the international community that the Rhodesian sanctions just wasn't working. They had the support of Portugal, the Salazar regime in Mozambique. They used the Beira port, which was a very key port for Rhodesian exports. That solved that matter. And then they also obviously had the South African ports with the rail network down to Richards Bay and Durban and et cetera, you know. Or quite simply put, South Africa could just buy their products and on-sell it. So that solved that problem. So up until 1974, 75, it wasn't an issue at all. The Rhodesian train steamed along quite nicely. But the internet, one particular gent who I'm still waiting for him to die, by the name of Henry Kissinger, solved this little problem. I don't know, is he still alive? I think he's 95 years old or something.
I think he's still alive. Let me check.
I'm still waiting for him to die, that guy. Mr. New World Order, Mr. Globalist.
No, he's still alive. He's 97.
Anyway.
He's on the good drugs.
Yeah, he's anyway, he's outlived, he's even outlived Mugabe. Can you believe it? Anyway, so Henry Kissinger then decided that, look, these sanctions aren't going to work. All right. What happened then? Well, at the same time that I don't know what happened in Portugal, but the Salazar regime failed in Portugal, I think after a coup, if I'm not mistaken. And that's actually what led to the Portuguese leaving Angola and Mozambique. A lot of people, I've heard it was because of the terrorists and the people rising up and that sort of thing. But I don't think that. I actually thought it was the regime change in Portugal and the change of policy that got them to exit. But that's what I think anyway. But so at the same time, Portugal's regime changed and they exited Mozambique. That took away Rhodesia's port at Beira. And then when Kissinger saw that, he said, oh, wait, hang on, I got a plan. And guess who he went and called? Another guy who's probably the worst person ever in charge of South Africa, and that's Forster, B.J. Forster. The worst head of state South Africa, probably the worst head of state South Africa's ever had.
Right? Quite the achiever.
Yeah, so, you know, so basically, I mean, he managed to, at the same time, Forster came up with some weird idea he had in his head. No, he was now going to, had a policy of détente with these frontline states. I don't know if you remember the policy of détente. No. He was now going to get the African countries to warm to South Africa. Mm. Right. Yeah. This guy, you know, some people come up with the strangest ideas.
Sounds a bit like what our politicians are saying today, that you need like some type of Southern African Union.
Yeah. I don't think he was talking about it. He was just on a propaganda sort of charm offensive with African neighboring states, you know, so with the likes of Zambia and obviously with Angola falling and then with Mozambique going over, and you know, he had this now policy. He was going to now convince the rest of Africa that you know, South Africa is a good nation and blah 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 blah.
They were never going good relations with the US.
Yeah, and he wanted good relations with the US, all right. So and the US wanted Rhodesia gone. So basically Henry Kissinger flew down to Pretoria to meet with B.J. Forster, and they came up with this idea, wait, hang on. I don't know exactly how the deal went down, but basically that's exactly when South Africa kind of pushed Rhodesia aside, at the same time offering détente to the rest of Africa. It's bizarre.
Yeah, I see. Sideline opinion says Forster closed the SA borders with Rhodesia.
Yeah, he prevented the oil and ammunition supplies and all that sort of thing as well. That's quite true. And basically from that period on, it started to become a lot more trickier for Rhodesia. They had to jump through a lot more hoops.
And what time was this now?
This is about 75, 76, around there. And at the same time, at the same time, the insurgency war, the Bush war, was intensifying at that same time. So within a matter of, say, 2 years, the situation had changed quite dramatically for Rhodesia.
In 1970, so maybe just for context, who were the sides fighting in that Rhodesian Bush war?
Well, in Rhodesia, you had the Matabele faction of Joshua Nkomo, which was ZAPU. And you had the Tongagara ZANU faction of Shona. Just remember, it was Tongagara back then, not Mugabe. Mugabe actually only was a latecomer to the show. Actually, he wiggled his way in there. That's another topic, another little conspiracy there. Yeah, so where were we?
The borders just closed.
Yeah, the borders are closed. So, you know, now the Zandla is fighting out of Mozambique. ZAPU's fighting out of Zambia. The borders are closed. You're fighting a battle on two fronts. You're on two borders, so you spread thin. You are under pressure economically. Forster's putting pressure on you. So you're really in a tight spot.
Did Rhodesia have any friends at that time?
I'm trying to think. I think the South African government actually kept everything pretty hush-hush. In those days, they didn't want to be shown to the South African public to be not supportive of Rhodesia. So I think I think Rhodesia would have had quite a lot of support with the ordinary South African public. But I think it was done very much at a diplomatic level and very much a subversive level. And that's another thing.
There's just a message here. So the message says in the chat, I knew a man in the 70s from Rhodesia in 2006. He had nowhere to go after leaving in a 2 euro night shared dorm in Malaysia. The guest house owner used to turn on the radio in the afternoon for him. And his favorite radio station, when they would play classical music, he would sit and close his eyes and seem a bit happy for a while. That was the first time I ever heard about Rhodesia.
Oh, okay. Interesting. Mm-hmm. That's very interesting. Yeah, look, yeah. So obviously all these pressures, I'm a bit murky as to the whole, how it all played down politically, but from what I can understand in Ian Smith's book, the short story was, it was a backstab from Forster, quite plainly put. That was it. I wouldn't say that was it. You know, you can see, I've actually checked the figures and that sort of thing. The economy started to take a bit of strain in those years. Look, everything was still functioning. They didn't have things like hyperinflation and, you know, food shortages, and there was none of that, you know. But obviously, government spending and government deficits were increasing. You don't have the access to foreign currencies. On the marketplace, it starts getting a bit intense. Obviously, the sanction busting techniques were pretty good. Somehow, they still managed to export enough goods to get their hands on foreign currency to balance their trade account. There wasn't a massive currency devaluation or anything like that. Somehow, obviously, the pressures just started to mount.
I see Robin McLaren says Israel was friendly to Rhodesia.
Yeah, thanks, Dad. Yeah, that's Dad. See the flag there on the side there.
Yeah. Right. So, yeah, so now we are at, where we are in history now, the independence is closing in 1980. To finish off the historical section, what were the final days like in regards to Rhodesia before it became Zimbabwe?
Well, under pressure, Ian Smith decided to reach an internal settlement with the non without ZANU PF or ZANU, ZAPU or ZANU. So they organized an internal settlement with Bishop Abel Mazarewa and his faction, and Abel Mazarewa became prime minister of the new country, which was called Rhodesia Zimbabwe or Zimbabwe Rhodesia in 1979. However, that government wasn't very strong. It came under too much pressure too quickly, and it succumbed to the British pressures to enter into Lancaster House Agreement, and in November 1979, the Lancaster House Agreement happened, and by March, April 1980, the next year, independence was through, you know, and that was pretty much it. That's like the timeline, how I understand it. That's how it happened.
Yeah, I see. Emily says the UK Labour government treated Ian Smith really badly.
Yeah, well, look, I mean, the thing is, them and America had already decided that Rhodesia must go. Simple put, you know, there is no negotiating about it. It was good that I still think it was worth it to give it a crack and not just a handover like that, because, yeah. That's my feeling. I still think UDI was worth it. I still do believe it was worth it. It was worth the effort.
Right. So another thing that now kind of came to the fore as we went through the history was pretty much the big successes that the Rhodesians were able to achieve. What was the foundation of these successes in regards to why they were able to really exist while they're being bombarded from all over the world in regards to sanctions and propaganda and people or countries pretty much turning their backs on them and not really having a lot of friends? And why were they able to build this very sophisticated economy that still, if you look at the timeline of the economy, Mugabe inherited a pretty sophisticated one. So what was the basis of that? Where did that success come from?
I think fundamentally the foundations were laid right from the beginning. I think one of the advantages of British colonialism, all right, was its efficient administration structures and systems that it put in place in its various countries. You just take a country like, say, for instance, Singapore. They didn't change much after they became independent. They carried the British fundamental structures of administration through, they continued them. So one of the things you can say what you like about it, the British Empire administratively they had an excellent, what they call a command and control system, where they don't need to micromanage an area. They put people in place who govern it in their own interests within boundaries, and they give, and that is very much. It's actually not too dissimilar as to what the Romans did back in the day. Not too dissimilar, you know. The British Empire weren't a bunch of micromanagers. Actually, they set the broad structures in place. They laid down the foundations. I suppose when you're dealing with a strong Anglo culture in Rhodesia, you're not going to get any sort of resistance. You're not going to need to micromanage because culturally you're aligned. You just issue a statement and it gets done, and you know it's quite easy to administrate that way, you know. So that's the one thing. Also, the people of Rhodesia seem to be a pretty intelligent bunch if one considers the performance of Rhodesian students at South African universities. I think on a per capita basis, they outperformed their South African counterparts. So they were a pretty smart bunch. The for some reason. I mean, nobody really knows why, but they were a pretty smart bunch. So that definitely helps. You know, you had some smart people up there. Make no mistakes about it. And the anecdotal evidence is how the South African students performed at, the Rhodesian students performed at South African universities. It's actually pretty well documented, that they outperformed their South African counterparts quite well. That was the other thing. And then also, I think if you take a very small economy like they had good industry, they had, they did innovate well, coming back to having quite a smart population. They had good innovation, good efficiency. Their ability to control an economy was, they didn't have a massive public service. I think also in those days, the culture of the day generally was can do, say what you like about the boomer generation and the generation before that. They're can do people, you know what I mean? Make no mistakes about it. They just get on with things and they get things done. You know, they work together well. And then also, I think that that efficiency, all those efficiencies spilled over into their military operations, which, you know, we haven't spoken much about the Rhodesian military, but that's pretty much what Rhodesia is actually famous for these days, you know. The historians love the Rhodesian Bush War setup, and they love all the innovation. That's another area where Rhodesia militarily were incredibly innovative in terms of tactics, etc. Some of the best counterinsurgency techniques were developed in the Rhodesian security forces.
Did they develop some of their own weapons or armored vehicles or anything of the
like? Yeah, they did. Yeah, they did. Obviously, they invented this mine vehicle, ugly looking thing. They developed a couple of things. Obviously, they never had, obviously, the massive funding to develop all the really fancy toys, but they made up for it in other areas. They did the basics well. They maintained their equipment well. They got a couple of, they even managed to somehow smuggle, I think it's 8 Bell helicopters into the country somehow. I don't know how they managed to do that with sanctions, 8 of them, or 8 or 12 or something like that. And obviously re-engineered them, fitted them out with what they needed to do for their operations. But I think the strength of the Rhodesian military, from what I've read I've read books on the Rhodesian Special Air Service, I've read books on the Rhodesian Light Infantry, on the Rhodesian Salu Scouts, etc. Their primary weapon was actually tactical, their ability to come up with outrageous ideas. I mean, if you think about it, a lot of people don't know what the Salu Scouts were. They weren't they weren't actually a reconnaissance. They were a reconnaissance unit, but the way they did reconnaissance was in a pseudo form. So they pretended to be the terrorists to gain. I mean, that's and not only that, what they used to the Salu Scouts. I mean, this is a technique. I don't think anybody else. I think 3-2 Battalion used this technique. Limited degree, but nowhere else in the world has ever done this. Where you capture a Zandla guerrilla, all right? You interrogate him, and you turn him into a Salu scout. You know who does that? That's outrageous. You know, that's pretty outrageous.
It's like something you get out of a film. That's something you think is an actual tactic.
No, but that tactic really happened. You know. And if you look at if you tell most military personnel all over the world, you know, your formal military in Europe or America, I think their eyes just about jump out of their sockets, you know, But that was the type of things that Rhodesia got up to make up for all the areas where they couldn't match with the fancy toy firepower, you know. Mm. And a lot of the tactics, all the basically 3-2 battalion and Kufut and all those units in the South African Defence Force were Jan Breitenbach and all those guys actually learned from Colonel Ron Reed Daly. You know, the knowledge was passed on to them. Ron Reed Daly was the commander of the Salu Scouts. He passed on all that information to, and then many of those operators ended up in the South African Defence Force in the 1980s as well. So they continued in operation there, so with their techniques and that sort of thing. But yeah, that I think if you could sum up Rhodesia's resilience would be absolute efficiency, more so than anything else. Their wealth was generated internally. So, you know, they were able to export just enough to import enough. So they balance your trade account, and spend and generate wealth internally. That's how you do it. And with a small economy like Rhodesia, it is, if you think of it, it is actually very, very possible.
So now that we've covered that, why it was successful, I think here comes the part where you're going to have a lot of people disagreeing with you or even taking you on, and that is, why did it fail? What were the key blunders, or the not even blunders on the Rhodesian side, maybe environmental stuff that went on in the world around them that kind of sealed their fate, do you reckon?
Yeah, there's lots of things, but it was not military. They didn't lose the war. Just putting that, making sure everybody knows that. There's a couple of things. We spoke briefly about Kissinger collaborating with Forster and the political climate. Basically, the global situation at the time was Rhodesia must go. That's one of the sort of that is a very, very difficult thing to get your head around if you want to survive as a country. You know, the rest of the world wants you gone, okay?
Oh, and you're not what even you a particularly big country in regards to your population.
Yeah, you know, you're not actually, and you haven't even harmed anybody. You haven't, there's no, you know, your own people internally, you're improving the quality, gradually improving the quality and living standards of your population internally, all race groups internally. It's improving all the time. Things are getting better for the average Rhodesian year in, year out. There's no reason for intervention from overseas. You know, like I'm not a big believer in democracy or majority rule. If I see something that I don't bother about, are they even having elections? I'm not going to ask questions. If I want to judge another country, I want to say, in one sentence, are the living standards of the majority of people improving? Full stop. That is how, whether a country is advancing or not. Because you can't eat and you can't eat human rights. You can't eat the right to vote. You know, all those sort of rights don't actually deliver anything tangible in and of themselves. That's just my sort of feeling on it. But to cut a long story short, it was the global sentiment at the time. There was also obviously tied to that, you must remember, I did some checking up, and from 1950 to 1980, the Rhodesian population went from about 2-3 million to about 8-9 million in 30 years. And that's a triple population. Now, usually population growth like that means a good quality standard of living, always does. You can, you know, I don't care what anybody says. That's why it was, that's why there was population growth, is because there was standards were, living standards were being raised continually. Obviously, you know, when you've got that type of demographic makeup, you know, the optics, I'll admit, you know, the optics within the political dispensation of the world, you know, you've got, you know, 250 odd thousand white people amongst six or seven with 6 or 7 black people, but the black people aren't running the country, so to speak, even though their living standards are improving. The optics aren't good, admittedly, you know, within the way people see things, not the way I see things, but the way people see things. That played a part, make no mistakes about that. Also, there was a lot of internal betrayal. I'm not talking about internal with the Forster situation, but I mean, the Rhodesian Central Intelligence Organization, the CIO, was riddled with agents, riddled. I mean, the head of the CIO, Ken Flower, was an MI5 agent, for goodness sakes. You know, this is not conspiratorial. I wouldn't say well documented, but well accepted. You know, it's one of the, you know, that's the, so, you know, they both the plots to, there were actually military plots to assassinate Joshua Nkomo and assassinate Robert Mugabe. But the plan was there, and both of those attempts were foiled by the British finding out about it. You know, whether that would have made a difference, I don't know. But definitely, when you've got leaks and agents and you know, you're trying to increase the morale of your population in a bit of a fight, you know, that deflates people tremendously. That, you know, that knocks the morale of the soldiers on the ground quite harshly. You know, when they has an impact. When they see things like operations having to get called off, all these sorts of things because of, you know, leaks and intelligence problems and all that sort of thing, that it has a massive mental effect on morale. That's what I think. And then, you know, also, I think to a lesser extent, another reason probably is the old idea, and Ian Smith was a big proponent of this. You know, he believed in the idea that, how can I put it, that he was doing him and his father before him were actually doing the right honorable thing by improving the lives of the African masses. Essentially, the idea that I'm getting at is that Smith and basically the English liberalism idea was one of the white man's burden, and the white man's burden was a matter of, no, look, it's patronizing, you can say that, but we are here to improve things. They really did believe that. They couldn't convince the rest of the world though, but they did believe that. I think that Ian Smith was quite sincere in that regard. But at the end of the day, I don't know if that was that's the right way to be thinking about things. I think they just found them there again. You know, when you're thinking one way, and you think everybody else that speaks the same language as you, being English, is going to think the same way as you. You know, you're thinking in the old way and they've changed their ways, you know. You're thinking in the pre-World War I, World War II and World War I ways, and they're thinking in the post-World War II order. You know, you're getting a mismatch there. You're not talking the same language. And a guy like Ian Smith, I'm afraid, was completely out of his depth. completely out of his depth. He was just far too nice a guy to deal with the savages that were coming. Lord, what was the guy's name? I think it was Soames, and what was the other guy's name, man? British guys. They were horrible. I mean, geez, they were real pieces of work. And I think you know, Smith was also, you know, the Rhodesians were too honorable and too trusting of the whole sort of situation, and that also didn't help as well. So it's never, like I say, I'll these are things that I've mentioned and discussed, how, yeah, all those things together, I think, led to Rhodesia's downfall.
I see here in the chat, Sideliner Opinions asks, was the other guy Lord Carrington?
I think that's the guy, yes, Carrington. I think that's it. Yeah, it is.
But Joe, now on that topic, what was the general sentiment in Rhodesia towards the crown?
I think it was generally positive. It was still actually positive in a sort of cultural way, but I think obviously relations would have soured in the 1970s years, as it became quite clear that the British were not their friends anymore, or the British establishment, or the British political class were no longer their friends, you know, and they had been expelled from the Commonwealth.
Well, that was at that time, but today, people that are ex-Rhodesians or people that are descended of Rhodesians, what is the sentiment today towards the treatment of the empire towards Rhodesia?
Well, I mean, the thing is, I don't hear a lot of positivity. I think my dad's listening at the moment. He'll confirm that he's got absolutely no. And neither do I, no sort of affinity or anything towards empire or anything like that. No, I think those sort of feelings are limited at best.
Right, and then also something that I promised we talk about is the myths and misconceptions around Rhodesia. Do you have any in mind that you'd like to clear up?
No, look, like I say, it's all about a narrative, you know. So it's the whole thing is framed, okay. Obviously, you know, you are looking. People always like to look at a situation that happened in Rhodesia through 21st century eyes, rather than the context of the time. And this is an old narrative story. You see it all the time when people talk about the past. They always look at it through the current lens. Which is completely false. I mean, the idea that, because, you know, these days, just simply because it's a white minority government, white supremacist regime, racist regime, and all that sort of thing. No, it's just a white minority government administrating the country. That's all, you know. Obviously, you know, I mean, you know, you're looking at it through optics of the 21st century. And I actually want to read something to you. I've actually got a quote here, which I want to read, which is actually a quote by one of those chiefs I spoke about earlier that was at this meeting. And this is what he actually, it was their unanimous view was that Rhodesia should be independent of Great Britain. So This is the statement by one of the chiefs. He says, yeah, now this is our custom. There's no such thing as one man, one vote, casting your vote on a piece of paper. This is quite foreign to our way of life. By our custom, our method of voting is to discuss the matter openly as we are doing today in this hall. After a matter has been discussed, anyone who has any objections is invited to stand up and give his reasons for objecting. And he says, yeah, we ask government to respect our customs and our ways of life. How can anyone expect us to cast aside all our tradition and live like animals without any culture. And he says here, there is only one important matter which is in dispute. The leaders of the British people, whom we have always trusted, have now turned around and accepted the views of some of our children, Joshua and Nkomo and company, and wish to ignore the traditional leaders of this country. It is quite clear that the British government have accepted this because these people are now the marauding lions in our country of Rhodesia. What he says here. He says here, the British way of doing things is completely incomprehensible to us. They carry on long protracted discussions and cannot arrive at a decision. One minute the power is in the hands of this person, the next it is in the hands of that person. In the meantime, murder is being done in our country. We are sick and tired of it. Let us have done with it. Let have our independence. So, number one, you can see by the statements that the chiefs were not interested in, and this is the 1960s, had no interest in who governed them, provided they could still be the leaders in their areas over their own people and in their own customs. And that is something that a Western European cannot get his head around, you know. Obviously, this is the 1960s. It was still, things were still developing back then. Literacy rates were improving, only starting to really take off across Africa. So things were only starting to happen then. But this is the type of, this is the other chief said here, we wish to state quite clearly that we support the government of Rhodesia and we do not accept the claim by the British Prime Minister that he has continuing authority for and over our people through the government and parliament of the United Kingdom. So one of the biggest myths is that there was no black support for UDI or white minority government.
And then another myth that I think you mentioned is that Ian Smith was a right winger.
Yeah, Ian Smith was actually an English liberal. So
or classical liberal, as they've been rebranded.
Yeah. Look, he was essentially a if you read his book, it's a long time ago that I read it. His biography, it's like 20 odd years ago that he wrote the thing, but. The way he put it, he was one of these guys that was engaging and always like a gentleman. You know, he wasn't this, Augusto Pinochet type character. You know what I mean? The Rhodesian government was hardly authoritative or authoritarian. Was actually pretty liberal, but at the same, pretty liberal on most things, the idea, they need to it's all about pushing a narrative that is completely not true, but if the storyline must line up, in other words, so and no deviation is allowed in the story ever. You know, it's only one story, and that has to be pushed the whole time. But Smith really was just a nice guy, softy gentleman. He was just a soft guy, gentlemanly character, couldn't hurt a fly, far too trusting, was hopelessly out of his depth, I think, in dealing with all the hyenas of the British and American and South African politicians.
So another thing that I want to discuss is pretty much, seeing as I do a culture series on this channel, is just a quick overview of what Rhodesian culture really was like. Was it just a satellite of Britain, or was there unique aspects to it that pretty much created a unique Rhodesian culture in regards to the values that they held and the worldview that they shared?
I think if you could categorize Rhodesian culture, it would probably be in the 1960s, 70s, the equivalent of pre-World War One England.
Agrarian England.
So, yeah. So, obviously, with Rhodesia not having suffered two major wars, and the impact that that had on English people in England, take that out of the equation, and that's pretty much what Rhodesia was. I think it was strong, sort of it was community based. People, community service was always part of Rhodesia. They served each other well, built their communities. I think certain things, they loved their outdoors. They loved their, they obviously, because they had the climate for it. They although they were a very small nation, they loved their sport. They, Rhodesia, they had great, all the great English school systems, like what you have, the English public schools systems were implemented in Rhodesia. Some of those schools are still going today. Actually, just about all of them are still going today. All those sorts of things, they created strong institutions around their communities to underpin everything. And yeah, I think it's very much a I think the shared values of people living there was, yeah, I think what made them strong.
Was there a shared religious element there?
I think largely yes. I think most of the Rhodesians were Christian. Obviously, you still had some, what people don't understand, there was a fair-sized Afrikaans community in Rhodesia as well. I think there's still an Inkia Kerk in Harare. I'm being serious. I think there is still one there. Obviously, your Rhodesians were either Anglican or Presbyterian, mostly Anglican Presbyterian type churches that would be up there. They shared a common faith, definitely. Many mission stations were established, Lutheran, Moravian, Catholic mission stations all over Zimbabwe to serve the people. Pretty much. I think it was at the same time a heavily Christianized country as well. The Christianity was pretty strong.
I see. Here's a very interesting story. Sideliner Opinion says Ian Smith fought in the Second World War for the British as a pilot, and he was shot down in Italy and walked over the Alps to join the Allied forces again.
Yeah, I actually read about that in his book. He fought with the I think some of the resistance, either the did he walk to Italy or did he walk to France? I'm not sure, but he ended up fighting with the resistance there for a while. Then he got picked up and brought back to England.
Mm. Yeah. So yeah, and then the other thing that I find quite funny is the fact that a lot of Rhodesians actually immigrated back to the UK. Back to the country that kind of turned their backs on them. What do you think is the psychology at play there? Someone in the chat said that Rhodesians were very patriotic. What do you think is going on there in their minds when you have to leave that country that you love and pretty much go back to the muddy island?
Yeah, look, I think I remember reading a particular, there was a reading a book about a SAS officer that joined the military in Rhodesia. We actually moved to Rhodesia for work. He had left the SAS in Britain and he moved to Rhodesia for work, and they found out that he was a SAS officer or SAS operator in the British SAS, and they offered him some military work, which he took up. He couldn't say no because it was just too much adventure for him. And I've read his book and what he had to say. And one of the things that he said in the book was, he said, I came from England. I didn't know anything about Rhodesia. I came out here for a job opportunity. I loved the place so much, and it adopted me. And, you know, he was actually very upset. He was actually very upset that he had to go back. Yeah, there you go. Kissinger and John Forster. There we go. He was reading this guy's book. He was incredibly upset about having to leave a country that had adopted him. It wasn't his an adopted country. In his view, the country had adopted him. Not to say he went back to England. I don't know what happened to him later on in life, but I don't know what he... Having said that, he went back, but it wasn't with a cheerful heart whatsoever. You know, it was just one of those things. You know, sometimes life goes like that.
Yeah, I see. Emily says the same feeling existed for the French Algerians when they had to leave for France in 1962.
I can think so. Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, it's a strange thing that happens here in Africa. I'm convinced there's some type of parasitic brain worm down here that infects European minds and kind of compels you to stay here.
No, look, it is like that. I mean, still to this day, I was chatting to my uncle has still got friends that live in Zimbabwe, and he said, you know, those buggers are resilient, eh? You know, they still love it. They can't leave. You know, there's an interesting. I've been following. There's the one lady that's lived there all her life. I used to follow. I haven't followed her letters for a while. She used to write on. I think she used to write for MoneyWeb when I used to follow Kathy Buckle. Wrote quite fascinating stories about what actually goes on in Zimbabwe. You know, like every once a month or 2 weeks. I think it's called Letters from Zimbabwe or something like that. It's quite fascinating to read her letters and hear like a personalized account. But she's still there. She hasn't left. She's been there the whole life. She never left. You know, she won't leave. She doesn't leave.
Kat says it's not a brain worm. It's a spider. It weaves a web inside our heads. Your guess is as good as mine. But yeah, and that's the thing. Discussing now that diaspora of Rhodesians. As they say in when looking back retrospectively, where are they now? What happened to a lot of those expats? Where did they go?
I mean, if you just follow the interest groups on Facebook, they literally are scattered quite far and wide. I would say the largest chunk, not the majority, but the largest chunk is here in South Africa, still, and is the rest are all scattered throughout the rest of the Anglosphere. So I'd say about 40% of them are, just a thumb suck, about 40% of them are in South Africa, the largest chunk, you know. You'll be surprised. I mean, it is quite fascinating, you know. It's interesting how through all the years, generations, there's just about always been Rhodesians or Zimbabweans in the Springbok rugby side. You know, it's like just one of those things. Going way back, I mean, from the 60s, 70s, 80s, always been, you know, at least one or two in the side. That's quite fascinating for me, you know.
Yeah, that's very interesting. And that's the thing, is that I think, and that's why I wanted to have this conversation, is I think I've met a lot of ex-Rhodesians here in South Africa in my time here so far. And the thing is, the Rhodesians that still live here kind of know the true story, but seeing as the global perspective on Rhodesia is either a villainous caricature or it's actually a bit of an exaggerated, magical, almost mythical image, which is also not accurate.
A lot of it has been hijacked by laughers.
No, absolutely. And that's the thing, is that many people look at these types of countries or these types of historical timelines, and they kind of wish they were there, or they wish that that was their culture, or that was they came from that lineage. I can only see it happening with Afrikaners as well, where a lot of people look at Afrikaner culture and Afrikaner history and are like, damn, I wish that those were my ancestors. And I think that's what we're seeing with these LARPers online, is that they look at Rhodesia's history and like, damn, those oaks were cool.
Reselling. All of a sudden now, the FN rifle is like this amazing rifle of those. Don't been around for it's only like the last few years, and you know, it's like just weird stuff, you know.
But yeah, we've reached the end of our conversation now, Russel. But I'll definitely have you on in the future. What are your final thoughts on the topics that we discussed tonight?
I think Rhodesia is a good lesson. There's a lot of good stories in it. There's a lot that can be learned from it. I think it's just so much, you know, in a country that essentially only was around for less than 100 years, probably what, 80, 90 years, right from the beginning, to have done that much, it deserves a lot of attention. It's a good model as to a micro sort of way of developing a country. If you were going to start a new country from scratch, from absolute zero, that would be quite a good model to and way to look at things. I think Rhodesia has a lot of lessons, other types of lessons, political lessons, financial and economic lessons, military lessons. So there's something for everybody. If you enjoy anything of any particular part about history, you'll find something you'll enjoy about Rhodesia, whether it's the military side, the economic side, the politics of it, all these sorts of things. It is a fascinating little window of time. And I would encourage people, it'll take you a while because there's a lot of info these days. People are still writing books on it. There's still books coming out on the matter. In actual fact, it's actually getting more popular.
Do you have any sources that you'd recommend, like online sources for people that want to quickly just jump into it without buying a book?
I'm trying to think of all the. There are interesting. Facebook groups, the Rhodesia Military Facebook group is a good group. They're always posting. If you're interested in the military history, they'll always be having discussions on there, and that's usually where you get a lot of it's actual people that were there. If you're into the military side, there's a couple of other books that have been written. I would advise, it might be difficult to get hold of it. I would advise you read Ian Smith's. I don't know any sort of websites that are authoritative and that sort of thing. But I would suggest you read Ian Smith's autobiography. He wrote an autobiography.
It's a real difficulty to get a hold of.
Yeah, it's quite difficult to get hold of. That's it. Yeah. He also wrote another one after that called Bitter Harvest, which I actually have never read. Which was post the early 2000s. He wrote it a few years before he died. I think that book came out in the late 90s, and he wrote another book in about 2003 around there somewhere called Bitter Harvest. I have actually never read that book, but I've read that book, The Great Betrayal. And Memories of Rhodesia is very good. They'll show you, look, that's another thing. On YouTube, there's an incredible amount of content on Rhodesia. I don't know where they get the stuff from. It's quite astounding how much content there is. There you go. Nice. That's it. I was right. Bitter Harvest. So you look, those books are very interesting to read because it's his account of what happened. You know, Ian Smith tells the story pretty well. That's a good source. There's a couple more controversial ones. This is a very short book as well, which I read to you earlier.
What's the title?
It's a self-published
Prime Minister Ian Smith. Okay.
The debunking of a myth. Basically, the myth that he was this hardliner, right-winger type character. That's the debunking side. You know what I mean?
Oh, or, man. You know, this comment is absolute gold. SAB is the new bitter harvest. Were there, that's actually a question I want to ask before we go. Were there any Rhodesian beers?
Yeah, in actual fact, they had Castle and Lion up there, but they didn't taste like the Castle and Lion in South Africa. It was weird. They had a different flavor. And then they had their own, it was still part of SAB bottling. And that. So when I went up to Zimbabwe in like 2000 or something to visit, they had a couple of brands up there that I remember. They had Zambezi Lager, which is quite a good beer. And they had another one called Bollinger's as well, which is also very good. I don't know if they were around in the 70s. I think they were. They had their own bottling beer and that sort of thing up there as well. Mm. Not everything was imported from South Africa.
Especially not after the border closed.
No. It wasn't closed permanently. It was just, somehow sanction busting was a. I'd like to find out exactly how they did all their sanctions busting. That would be quite fascinating. You know, anybody can figure out where that can find that would be cool.
Mm. Well, there you have your challenge. Well, thank you very much, Russell, for joining me tonight for this excellent discussion. I enjoyed it a lot, and the chat seems to have enjoyed it as well. And thank you very much, everyone else, that tuned in. If you are interested in what Russell has to say on other matters, you can go check out his YouTube channel that he co-hosts. There's a link in the description. Definitely recommend. And then also, Russell, I'll definitely have you on in the future, maybe for a different topic, but this one was very fascinating.
Thanks, Ernst. Yeah, it's great to just chat as just ordinary people. You know, we're not experts. We're just talking and sharing our thoughts and our chibuku. Is that not sorghum beer? So it's just nice to sit and talk openly and just, you know, not as a academic discussion, but just as, you know, how people have seen it and how families have seen it.
Yeah, no, but thank you very much, and I'll definitely try and get another topic another chat on the matter going in the future. I just have to think in terms of what angle, what still needs to be discussed. Kat says, excellent chat, gentlemen. Sideline Opinion says, thank you, Russell and Aaron, for bringing back great Rhodesian memories. and White Noise Podcast says, Russell and Carrigal, thanks. P.S. Russell is a boot.
Boots.
All right. And also, if you're new to the channel, you can also like and subscribe. That helps out a lot. And if you're watching and it's not live and you have any opinions of your own that you want to leave, you can leave it in the comments. And I see here 99 Iron Duke says, damn, you missed this. We'll go back and watch it. Yes, it will definitely be worth your time. But thank you for tuning in at the last second. Shaq Dwell also says, awesome guest, Ernst. Oh, thank you very much, everyone.
Yay, thanks.
All right. So have a good evening, everyone. And I'll check you again on the next episode. Cheers, guys. Have a good one.
Cheers, guys.